say, "Mom, you should start it," when she had said this? I'm just guessing that that's probably kind of...
Sorry, everyone. Are we there?
When she had said this, she went away and called Mary, her sister, saying secretly, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and was coming to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha met him. Then the Jews who were with her in the house and consoling her, when they saw that Mary got up quickly and went out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Therefore, when Mary came where Jesus was, she saw him and fell at his feet, saying,
"Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died."
When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled.
"Where have you laid him?"
"Lord, come and see."
Jesus wept.
"See how he loved him?
Could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man also from dying?"
So Jesus again, being deeply moved within, came to the tomb. Now it was a cave, and a stone was lying against it.
"Remove the stone."
"Lord, by this time there will be a stench, for he has been dead 4 days."
"Did I not say to you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?"
So they removed the stone.
"Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but because of the people standing around, I said it, so that they may believe that you sent me. Lazarus, come forth."
The man who had died came forth, bound hand and foot with wrappings, and his face was wrapped around with a cloth.
"Unbind him and let him go."
Therefore, many of the Jews who came to Mary and saw what he had done believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them the things which Jesus had done. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Before I begin, I would like to draw your attention to that very important verse, verse 28, when Martha comes to Mary and Martha says to Mary, "The teacher is here and is calling you." And of course, Mary hears this and it says she got up quickly. But the word calling is very important in John's Gospel, and it comes from the Greek word that we get the word phone from. It's the verb voice, the voice, or the phone. And interestingly enough, it occurs just a chapter before this in chapter 10, where Jesus talks about himself as being the good shepherd, "And my sheep hear my voice, and they know me, and they follow me." And this word getting up quickly is actually the word in Greek for resurrection, and it's in the passive, so she was raised. She was resurrected. And so in essence, more than one person was called out of death into life in this wonderful story about the raising of Lazarus. It's the same voice that calls Lazarus from the grave, and it's the same voice that speaks to you in your baptism. Sisters and brothers, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. You don't understand. You don't make the timeline. The virus makes the timeline. Sobering words from Dr. Anthony Fauci, the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. He spoke them just this past week at a news conference. Reporters were pressing him for some sort of timeline, some sort of prediction as to when this virus will run its course and we can get our lives back to normal. When finally, in a moment of frustration, Dr. Fauci gets firm. "You don't understand. You don't make the timeline. The virus makes the timeline." Oh, it's not that we just don't understand, as if it's simply a matter of getting a little more information, a few more facts and figures, and then the light goes on. No, it's because this is something that we don't want to hear. We've grown so accustomed to things that are instant. Instant gratification, instant credit, instant coffee. And we've grown so accustomed to things that are fast. Fast food, fast loans, fast internet speeds, and fast speeds on the interstate. But now everything has slowed down to a snail's pace. And all we can do is wait, which for most of us is one of the most difficult things we can do, especially when so much is on the line. This virus has affected so many things, not just our health and well-being, which is significant enough, but also our work and therefore our ability to pay bills, house payments, rent payments, utility payments, car payments, and putting food on the table. Pensions and stock portfolios have plummeted, and this virus has disrupted the education of our children and college students, and disrupted our healthcare system, closing clinics and putting elective surgeries on hold. Even our ability to gather for worship, or something as simple as getting into the car and going out for a bite to eat. And this could go on for months. In essence, this virus, with its own timeline, its own set of rules, is exerting its control on our entire world. And there's the operative word, don't you think? Control. It's the reason not only that we don't understand, but the reason we don't want to hear. As you've heard me say so many times before, it is the secret desire of every human heart to be in control. Okay, maybe not so secret. And this virus disrupting our world, intruding and rudely elbowing its way into our everyday lives, reminds us that we are not in control. And really, when all is said and done, it's not simply the virus that is exerting its control, but something we fear even more. Death. Death. To paraphrase Dr. Fauci, you don't understand. You don't make the timeline. Death makes the timeline. A bitter reality that we just don't want to hear. Funeral director and author Tony Walter puts it this way. Whatever else it is, death is the final triumph of nature, the triumph of inevitable physical decay over our will to stay young and healthy. For those who can, at the flick of a switch, turn night into day, winter into summer, and that's control, it is puzzling to understand how the light can eventually go out for good. For people who think every problem has a technological solution, it is disturbing to discover that for some illnesses there is no cure. For people who are used to taking the car into the garage for service, knowing they can buy a new model if the news is bad, it is disturbing to find themselves frightened as they enter the hospital for a checkup. Did you hear that? Death is the final triumph of nature, inevitable and puzzling to understand. You don't understand. You don't make the timeline. Death makes the timeline. Now, in many respects, today's gospel reading, Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, is about death's timeline. And apparently, Jesus missed the timeline. Lazarus is dead. Jesus is too late. At least, that's what Martha and Mary, the sisters of Lazarus, are thinking. And they say as much. Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died. Spoken first by Martha and shortly thereafter by Mary. Lord, if you had been here. Can't you hear in this comment the frustration? Perhaps even a certain amount of accusation or blame. Maybe Jesus could have been a bit faster, used a bit more haste in responding to their desperate plea for him to come and help. And Lord only knows what Martha and Mary would have said had they known that Jesus deliberately waited. Can't you just hear the disciples whispering among themselves after hearing Martha and Mary's comment? I'm not going to tell them. You tell them. No, you tell them. And just why did Jesus wait? Think of all the pain that he put Martha and Mary through. All the anguish, all the waiting, waiting, watching the clock, glancing over at the door, looking out the window, and back to watching the clock again. This feeling of utter helplessness, listening to their brother's every breath, seeing more and more clearly, they don't make the timeline. No, bitter, ugly death. That's what makes the timeline. And then the timeline came. Lazarus breathed his last, and hope is gone. And Jesus is nowhere to be found. For four more days! Why all that anguish? Why all that struggling and grief? Why did he put these two women whom he loved through so much watching and waiting and waiting and waiting? And maybe today, some 20 centuries later, we may ask something similar. Why do we, people of faith, have to wait? Why is it necessary for all the struggles and all the trials? Perhaps it's as Eugene Peterson writes, suffering is an event in which we are particularly vulnerable to grace, able to recognize dimensions in God and depths in self. Or again, these words from Mr. Rogers, from Fred Rogers, sometimes slow is better in understanding, in learning to be patient, in going deeper spiritually. Or how about these words from Martin Luther? When faith begins, God does not forsake it. That's well and good. But then listen to this. He lays the holy cross on our backs to strengthen us and to make faith powerful in us. The Holy Gospel is a powerful word. Therefore, it cannot do its work without trials. And only he who tastes it is aware that it has such power. Where suffering and the cross are found, there the gospel can show and exercise its power. It is a word of life. Therefore, it must exercise all its power in death. In the absence of dying and death, it can do nothing, and no one can become aware that it has such power and is stronger than sin and death. Or finally, these words from Robert Capon. Grace only works on those who it finds dead enough to raise. Grace only works on those it finds dead enough to raise. And if I might add, not only Lazarus, but Martha and Mary as well. Grace only works on those it finds dead enough to raise. Well, regardless of all this, speculating as to why Jesus made them wait, back to Bethany and dead Lazarus. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Perhaps the most important thing in these words spoken by Martha and Mary is something not spoken. An assumption that we don't hear, but is there just the same. An assumption also there in the comment made by the onlookers. Could not he who opened the eyes of a blind man have kept this man from dying? This assumption, simply put, is that as great as Jesus' powers are, they are no match for the timeline of death. The final triumph of nature, the triumph of inevitable physical decay. And so this teacher, this one who loved Lazarus, loved Martha and Mary, let death have this supposed final triumph over Lazarus, just as he will let death have its supposed triumph over you and me. But then there's this voice, the voice of the Good Shepherd. Lazarus, come out! And just as Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice, and they follow. The dead man Lazarus comes out alive. And even so, the teacher is calling you. Can you hear him? Nothing. Not even death will snatch you out of my hand. In the end, Dr. Fauci is wrong. The virus, indeed death, does not make the timeline, nor do they have the final word. The one who does have the final word is calling you today, calling you from death to life. My sheep hear my voice, and they follow. You are mine.
Call me out on the water.
Let us now say together the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
For our prayers today, I will conclude each petition with, "Hear us, O God," and you can respond with, "Your mercy is great." Turning our hearts to God, who is gracious and merciful, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Bind your people into one body. Accomplish your work of salvation in us and through us, for the sake of your world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, you love the world that you have made, and you grieve when creation suffers. Restore polluted lands and waterways, and heal areas of this world ravaged by storms, floods, wildfires, droughts, and other natural disasters. Bring all things to new life. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Show redemption to all who watch and wait with eager expectation. Those longing for wars to cease, those waiting for immigration paperwork to finalize, those seeking election, those in dire need of humanitarian relief, and all who wait in this time of uncertainty. Come with your hope. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of life, you weep with those who grieve. Combine all who are held captive by anxiety, despair, or pain, especially Nancy, Ed, Wayne, Malvern, Dennis, Susan, Al, Joyce, John, Betty, Emma, Margaret, Mary, Dale, Lois, James, Kelly, Stephen, Lucas, and Connie, and the family of Donald. And for those who are working in the healthcare field, and those who are ill with the coronavirus, and those who are facing financial instability, fill us with compassion and empathy for those who are struggling, and keep us faithful in prayer. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
According to your steadfast love, O God, hear these and all our prayers that we commend through and to you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Beside you to befriend you, above you. Thanks be to God.